presentation is, as you just said, about the regional level of migration governance, and the topic is analytical framework for regional migration governance in Africa. And I will talk about key features, patterns, and impacts in the ECOWAS and GATT regions. I will briefly tell you about the structure of the presentation. I will first provide background on the research project my presentation is related to, or the topic is related to. Then I will briefly elaborate on key migration trends in the two case study regions. And then I will come to the centerpiece of the presentation, which is migration governance at the regional level. And I will first talk about some conceptual requirements and challenges. Then I will present the framework on regional analysis for regional migration governance. And afterwards, I will at least slightly apply the framework in talking about how migration governance manifests itself in the IGAD and ECOWAS regions. And afterwards, I will conclude with proof of it. I shall also say it's not only my research I'm talking about, but actually it's research I'm doing together with Benjamin. So I'm the one who's presenting, but afterwards the questions can be to both of us. Okay, I come to the project background. The title of the project both of us are working for at the moment is reducing the root causes of both displacement and managing migration, global and regional perspectives. The project is funded by the German Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, short UNZ, and it has a total duration of 3 years and has started at the beginning of this year, meaning also that we are still relatively at the beginning of our work in that project. The project has two components. One is about the multi-dimensional analysis of the causes of forced displacement, and the second one is on regional migration governance. And as you may guess from the red writing or mark, that's the one I will be focusing on now, regional migration governance, using the two case studies I've already mentioned on ECOWAS and IGAD regions. What are the main questions we are focusing on in our research? The first is, what are current migration trends and their impacts in the case study regions? The second is, what are the institutional setups and processes of regional migration governance? And the third is, who are the involved actors and their interests? And what kind of interactions can be observed between regional, national, and also sub-national levels of migration governance. So very broadly speaking, we're interested in two aspects. On the one hand, we're looking at the effects or the effectiveness of regional migration governance. And second, to go a step further, we're also, in a more normative manner, interested in the implications for development cooperation, what could be recommendations that can be given to funders such as the PMZ and also others. In terms of the methodology, we use a mixed qualitative methodology, and we are using analysis of policy documents. We're doing expert interviews and also observations, apart from obviously also this review of secondary literature on the topic. Now I come to the key migration trends in the two case study regions, starting with IGAD. In the IGAD region, we can see that more than 50% of international migration occurs within the region. But apart from this, there are also quite large flows to the Middle East and Europe. The IGAD region is among the major refugee and producing and hosting regions in the world. And so there are really large flows of refugees, but an even higher flow of internally displaced people. You can also see this by the fact that some IGAD countries, such as Ethiopia, Kenya, and Uganda, are among the 10 the top 10 refugee-hosting countries in the world. Now, in terms of ECOWAS, what can we see here in terms of migration patterns? We see a larger level of intra-regional migration, which has already been mentioned by Professor Abumila, that it's extremely large in the ECOWAS region. More than 90% of migration is occurring within the region. We have long-standing patterns of seasonal and circular migration, and also very high importance of case tourism. This is also important in IGAD regions, but it's even more mentioned for ECOWAS. And Nigeria and Ivory Coast are two long-standing migration magnets in the region, but the region has also seen some changing developments in that regard. Now I come to the main aspect, which is regional migration governance and analysis of it. I'm talking about some conceptual requisites for Benjamin and I were confronted with, or were also thinking about. We wanted that actually all phases of the policy cycle are somehow attended to and covered in our framework of analysis, meaning that the framework looks at agenda setting, looks at policies, implementation, but also at impacts. Then we thought it was important to also attend to institutional capacities and the differential agenda setting power, which is included in regional migration governance. And we also thought we wanted this framework to have both descriptive and also explanatory qualities. Some challenge we encountered when developing it was that there were actually few models for analyzing regional level migration and governance, at least very few models to look at it in quite an encompassing manner we wanted to we were thinking about doing. There were existing frameworks, but they either looked at norms or at institutional capacities or institutional activeness, but not really all the aspects we were interested in. So as a result, we inspired ourselves by different sources, by different schools of thought, and put together rather an eclectic sort of model. That's what I would like to present now. This is the framework, and what you can see here is are the main criteria we are looking at, and then what we call sub-criteria or sub-questions. It's more detailed aspects we attend to within the framework, and also the rationale of both the criteria and the sub-criteria. I will briefly present the criteria. It's the first one is foundational factors. So to what degree basically has migration been an important issue of policy making in the history of the respective organization? Also to see whether migration somehow forms part of institutional identity, or we would call it. Then the second aspect is institutional capacities and main actors. So we were looking at structures and processes, and to what degree there are specific structures and processes for migration-related purposes and policies, and also the relationship between member states and the respective influence of external actors, for instance, donor agencies. The third criteria is the normative approach. So we were interested in to what degree does the regional organization to what degree has adopted international norms, global norms on migration, and also does it rather orient itself by a rights-oriented narrative or normative approach, or rather look at free movement issues, rather look at migration development issues, or does it have more security focus? And the last criteria is transfer into policies, written policies and practices, and that's what I've already said before in terms of the policy side, but not only interested in the normative level, but also to what degree these norms are actually observed and implemented on the ground. Now I will briefly provide examples or at least illustrate the analysis framework by elaborating on EGAT and ECOWAS and how these different criteria apply for them. Coming to the foundational factors, in terms of EGAT, one can say there's a relatively recent focus on migration. The historical policy focus has been on other issues, on growth and development, that was sort of the foundational issue, but also on security issues, which is not surprising given problems the region is experiencing or has been experiencing already in the last decade. And the migration programming only started in 2008. In terms of ECOWAS, this is very different. Migration has been important from the very beginning, starting with a free movement protocol, and has been a policy issue almost as long as the organization itself has been existing. So migration is also, has always been in ECOWAS strongly related also to the regional economic integration agenda. So quite different experiences in the two regions. Coming to the institutional capacities issue, we see for the case of EGAT, the organization has a known migration program, and that's the main operational structure. However, it does not have a mandate for decision making on behalf of the member states. So you can say it has a very strong intergovernmentalist orientation as opposed to a supranationalist one. We'll come to this aspect just in a minute. And it also shows quite unequal power relations within the organization itself. An informant said Ethiopia is running the show. That's just very briefly pointed out. And EGAT's policy agenda and migration is also heavily influenced by external interests and funding, particularly from the side of the EU. In terms of ECOWAS, it's again different. The organization has relatively strong decision-making competencies. Since 2005, the Secretariat has become a commission and has even higher enforcement and implementation competencies. So you can say, in contrast to EGAT, with this intergovernmentalist orientation, ECOWAS has a supranationalist orientation, again, being able to take decisions on behalf of the member states. There are also different unequal power relations in ECOWAS or differential influences, particularly manifesting in the leadership role of Nigeria. In total, one can say the European migration agenda is a little bit less influential, even though it also does have influence with ECOWAS. Third point, the normative approach, starting with EGAT again. The main strategic or policy documents, which are the regional migration policy framework and the action plan, suggest quite a comprehensive approach. If you look at discussions and what is actually, what cases are made in the discussions, one can say that there's quite a tension between external, very security and control, migration control focused interests, and rather migration and development related interests on the part of member states. But that's quite complex. And for the case of ECOWAS, one can say that it's probably a more comprehensive approach. There's quite a comprehensive movement protocol, free movement protocol, with three subsequent phases, which consist of visa free entry, right of residence, and right of establishment, respectively. And also the common approach, there's a common approach to migration and development that's been introduced or formulated in 2008. And that includes also migrant and refugees' rights in the agenda. Coming to the last point, transfer into policies and practices, and that's probably the category where we can find most commonalities between the two regional organizations. In the case of IGAD, one can say, even though there are quite impressive policies and quite comprehensive ones in terms of migration, there is very little cascading down on of regional policies on domestic migration policies and management. There are very weak, generally speaking, national migration policy frameworks in almost all member states or non-existing, but nevertheless, what one can talk about an increasing programming at the regional level. Now, in the case of ECOWAS, looking again at the free movement protocol that's been mentioned already twice, the third phase of the free movement protocol remains still to be implemented, although this originally was intended for much earlier, for more than 25 years ago. So there is also quite some implementation standing out. Also, the implementation of the regional labor and employment policy for the support of the regional labor market is still outstanding. Okay, I come to the conclusion and the outlook. In terms of the framework, I think I could somehow show it allows quite an encompassing analysis of regional migration governance. It also allows to identify and contrast important elements and determinants of regional migration governance. And looking more at the application and its application in the ECOWAS and IGAD regions, one can say that in spite of important, even fundamental differences partly between the two regions, there are also certain commonalities that can be observed, particularly the one relating to the implementation challenges. And that's more something which is definitely an outlook. Ideally, we hope that the framework provides the basis for addressing gaps or problem areas at the regional and also other levels of migration governance in the near future. We will see. Thank you very much.